By now, we have an application that works end-to-end via Spring's web client. Last lesson, we introduced a new RSocket server, which is currently running, and in this video, we're going to see how to create a client to connect to it. As with the web client's doc client, we're going to drive the RSocket client with an integration test. The test looks almost identical to the web client's doc client integration test, so let's copy this test and rename it to RSocket doc client integration test. We need to change this to work with an RSocket client. First, let's declare an RSocket doc client variable. RSocket doc client doesn't exist yet, so let's create it. For now, we'll leave it as an empty class so our test compiles. We'll come back here in a minute. We'll use the rename refactoring to rename this variable so it's correctly changed everywhere it's used. And again, this needs to be an RSocket doc client. We know this isn't going to need a web client, because that was only needed for the web client's doc client. The test assumes a pricesFor method. We want the RSocket functionality to work exactly the same as the web client functionality, so we'll assume our test is correct. Let's create the missing method on RSocket's doc client. Of course, the method declaration looks exactly the same as it does in web client's doc client, so it feels like a good time to introduce an interface that both clients can implement. We can use IntelliJ IDEA's Extract Interface feature to create an interface for web client's doc client to implement. It seems logical to call this interface doc client, and we want the pricesFor method to appear on the interface since this is the method that has the same signature on both client classes. We can get IntelliJ IDEA to replace the use of web client's doc client with the doc client interface instead if we want. Let's just go ahead and do the refactor without making any additional changes. Our web client's doc client class has been updated to add the override annotation onto the pricesFor method and to implement our new doc client. We want to do something similar in RSocket's doc client. So let's go to that class and have it implement doc client and add the override annotation to document that this method implements the method on the interface. Now our test is compiling, we can run it to see it fail. It should fail since we haven't implemented the actual functionality yet. Indeed, it fails on the assert not null assertion since we're returning null from the pricesFor method. Normally, with test-driven development, we'd take small steps to make the tests pass and have more granular tests. For this lesson, we're going to jump right in and implement the working RSocket client. To make an RSocket connection, we need an RSocket requester. This module doesn't have the correct dependencies yet, so let's go to our pom.xml file. Let's duplicate one of the Spring Boot Starter dependencies and change it to Spring Boot Starter RSocket. IntelliJ IDEA will download the correct dependencies and add them to the module. Back in the RSocket doc client, we can now add the import for RSocket requester. We'll make the field private and add a constructor parameter for it. Now we can use the RSocket requester, giving it a root. In our case, the root is the string value in the message mapping annotation of our RSocket controller method. We also need to send some data to the server. In our case, this is the stock symbol. Then we need to state the type we expect the call to return, which is a flux of stock price objects. We think this method should work, so we'll rerun the test. The test doesn't compile because we added an RSocket requester constructor parameter, and we don't have an instance of RSocket requester in our test. Let's create a method called createRSocketRequester in the test. Let's move it to the top, near where other objects are typically initialized. To create an RSocketRequester, we use the builder inside RSocketRequester. If we add the auto-wired annotation, Spring will inject an instance of this into our test. To finish up creating our RSocketRequester, we're going to connect via TCP to our RSocket server, which is running on localhost at port 7000. We need to call block to wait until we're connected. We're using AutoWired because we want Spring to inject dependencies into the test. To tell Spring to manage the test, we need to annotate it with Spring Boot Test. We expect this to work when we run it, but actually we're missing something important. We get an error that we're missing a Spring Boot configuration, which might be a little puzzling. In fact, this module doesn't have a Spring Boot application at all, because it was designed to be library code shared amongst other application code. It's not an application in its own right. One way to get our test to work in this case is to create a test application in our test directory and annotate this as our Spring Boot application. We don't need to do anything else, and when we rerun our integration test, everything starts up as expected. The test even passes. Since the test passes, we can assume the client successfully connects to the server via RSocket, gets a flux of stock prices, can take the first 5 of these, and checks the first one has the correct symbol. This is a slightly simplistic approach to testing reactive applications. There are other approaches, one of which is to use the StepVerifier. Using this approach, we can code our expectations for the events that we see. For example, we could take just 2 prices from the flux of stock price and expect that both of these prices have the correct symbol. By calling verify complete, not only do we check these expectations are met, but also that there are no more stock price objects after our expected 2. We can actually replace our original assertions entirely with a step verifier with 5 expectations. This approach can support much more than this simple example, and is also very useful for testing time-based publishers like ours. We have one final piece to consider. Our web client stock client defined a retry backoff strategy and a simple approach for handling errors. We can actually apply exactly the same approach to our RSocket stock client as well. When we rerun the test, we see it all still works as expected. So now we have an RSocket server on the backend emitting stock prices and an RSocket client that can connect to it and see those prices. In the next video, we're going to see how to switch from using the web client stock client to using our new RSocket stock client. Thanks for watching.